I'm very excited about the parts that were delivered already today. In case my printed circuit is working correctly, it's good news for anyone who wants to build that project. When you are prototyping DIY electronics, you will eventually come to a point where you are saying, if I only had created a printed circuit earlier. It's actually not as complicated as I thought. After just a few days, I was able to design a printed circuit myself using the program KiCAD. In the last video, we explained that process and we uploaded the so-called Gerber files to a PCB manufacturer. The ordering was super easy. The mailbag from PCBWay arrived today, and of course I'm super curious about how my PCBs turned out. 10 days after I placed the order, the printed circuits are already on my table. Wow, this is superior quality. Not only the board and the copper layers, the labels and logos are also looking great. I'm really impressed. Thank you, PCBWay. Excluding shipping, my 5 PCBs were around $25, which is really a fair price. The conducting layers are perfectly manufactured and all dimensions are matching exactly to my specifications. The soldering pads are already prepared and connected to both copper layers. Everywhere else the board is covered with protective coating. It's really great that this is affordable for DIY projects. Of course, since I designed the printed circuit myself, I also have to test it. Although I have verified my circuit using the schematic and the layout on paper, I want to do a physical inspection of the electrical connections. I have no doubt that the PCB is okay. However, at this point in time, I cannot exclude 100% that I confused any connections. First, I'm measuring the connections between soldering pads with my multimeter. This way, I can test whether conductive connections are where they should be and that they are not where they shouldn't be. Then I thought about a clever approach to populating the board. I start with the simple and cheap components and test them before I'm soldering the expensive components onto the board. The connection pins are helpful when testing, so they go on the board first. Then I'm soldering the components for the two voltage dividers. I measure the voltage arriving at the ESP32 pins when I apply 20 volts at the connection pins of my PCB. I need to adjust the two trimmer potentiometers so that we get about 3.3 volts after the voltage divider, because that is the maximum that the ESP32 input is able to measure. We will precisely calibrate the voltage dividers later. The four switching diodes are limiting the voltage at the inputs and are also ensuring that no damage is caused by incorrect polarity. Next, I'm soldering all the series resistors and the LEDs. I can test the LEDs and the buzzer, applying 3.3 volts to the ESP32 output pins that will later control the LEDs and the buzzer. For that purpose, the labeling on the printed board helps a lot. Of course, the ESP32 development board is not assembled at this point in time. It seems that the LEDs are all working and the buzzer also does what it is supposed to. Next, I'm soldering the stabilization capacitors. I can test these by connecting the pins for 5 volts and 3.3 volts, one after the other with my multimeter. We should see the typical charging behavior of a capacitor, namely increasing resistance. Like all engineers, I'm always cautious. That's why I'm soldering connector strips to plug the ESP32, at least for the first PCB that I'm populating. Next time, when I'm sure that everything is working fine, I will directly solder the ESP32 development board. Now we are connecting the peripheral elements. I connect the sensors, each having ground, 3.3 volts power supply and a signal line. Next, I'm connecting the relay boards to 5 volts, ground and a signal line. I already entered my local Wi-Fi credentials and uploaded the code. Okay. Now please hold your breath, because I'm turning on the electronics for the first time ever. It's booting, and yeah, it's coming up. I can now control the lab counter via the browser interface, and all commands seem to work. The starting light sequence and the relays are working fine. I'm now simulating the model racing cars with my finger, which I'm moving close to the sensors a few times. Instead of the start-stop reset buttons, I'm using a jumper cable here. And what can I say? It all works fine. If anyone is still holding breath, please keep on breathing now. Guys, we now have a nice hardware platform that I can continue working with. So there will be certainly be a version 2.0 of the project, which is more compact. Incidentally, the schematic has not changed compared to the previous pilot project. So new software versions will also run on the old hardware. And there are some new features in the pipeline that I would like to implement in the Arduino code. For example, there is a Wi-Fi manager and new features that are based on voltage measurement. Here's a little tip. It makes sense to set a fixed IP address for the lab counter in your Wi-Fi router. What a difference the PCB makes! I'm now completely convinced that you should seriously consider professional PCBs for your DIY projects. Designing with KiCAD is easy. Even I managed to design a printed circuit, even though I had never done it myself before. The cost for production is fair, and then you have the advantages of a printed circuit. The electronics is looking more professional, it is more resilient, and it is much easier to replicate. And the latter is particularly important, because I want to suggest easy to replicate projects on this channel. Now stay tuned and don't forget to support the channel. See you soon in the coming episodes.